Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents A Ghostly Murder by Tonya Kappes, narrated by Tiffany Morgan. Chapter 1. Ding, ding, ding! The ornamental bell on an old cemetery headstone rang out, no one touching it, no wind or breeze. The string attached to the top of the bell hung down the stone and disappeared into the ground. To the naked eye, it would seem as though the bell dinged from natural causes, like the wind. But my eye zeroed in on the string as it slowly moved up and down, deliberately. I stepped back and looked at the stone. The chiseled words, "I told you I was sick, Mamie Sue Preston," were scrolled in fancy lettering. Her date of death was a few years before I took over as undertaker of Eternal Slumber Funeral Home. Granted, it was a family business I had taken over from my parents and my granny. Some family business. Ding, ding, ding. I looked at the bell. A petite, older woman with a short gray bob neatly combed under a small pillbox hat was doing her best to sit ladylike on the stone with one leg crossed over the other. She wore a pale green skirt suit. Her fingernail tapped the bell, causing it to ding. I couldn't help but notice the large diamond on her finger, the strand of pearls around her neck, and some more wrapped on her wrist. And with a gravestone like that, I knew she came for money. "Honey, child, you can see me, can't you?" she asked, her lips smacked together. She grinned, not a tooth in her head. There was a cane in her hand. She tapped the stone with it. "Can you believe they buried me without my teeth?" I closed my eyes, squeezed them tight, opened them back up. "Ta-da! Still here." She put the cane on the ground and tap danced around it on her own grave. "Don't do that! It's bad luck!" I repeated another southern phrase I'd heard all my life. She did another little giddy-up. "I'm serious," I said in a flat, inflectionless tone. "Never dance or walk over someone's grave. It's bad luck." "Honey, my luck couldn't get any worse than it already is." Her face was drawn, her onyx eyes set, her jaw tensed. "Thank God you are here. There is no way I can cross over without my teeth." She smacked her lips. "Oh, by the way, Digger Spears just sent me, and I passed Cephas Hardy on the way. He told me exactly where I could find you." She leaned up against the stone. "Let me introduce myself." She stuck the cane in the crook of her elbow and adjusted the pillbox hat on her head. "I'm the wealthiest woman in Sleepy Hollow, Mamie Sue Preston, and I can pay you whatever you'd like to get me to the other side. But first, can you find my teeth?" I tried to swallow the lump in my throat. This couldn't be happening. Couldn't I have just a few days off between my betweener clients? I knew exactly what she meant when she said she needed my help for her to cross over, and it wasn't because she was missing her dentures. "What do you say?" Mamie Sue pulled some cash out of her suit pocket. She licked her finger and peeled each bill back one at a time. "Emily!" I heard someone call. I turned to see Granny waving a handkerchief in the air and bolting across the cemetery toward me. Her flaming red hair darted about like a cardinal as she weaved in and out of the gravestones. "See," I muttered under my breath and made sure my lips didn't move, "Granny knows not to step on a grave." "That's about the only thing Zula Faye Rains Payne knows," Mamie said. My head whipped around. Mamie's words got my attention. Amusement lurked in her dark eyes. "Everyone is wondering what you are doing clear over here when you are overseeing Cephas Hardy's funeral way over there." Granny took a swig of the can of Stroh's she was holding. Though our small town of Sleepy Hollow, Kentucky, was a dry county, which meant liquor sales were against the law, I had gotten special permission to have a beer toast at Cephas Hardy's funeral. I glanced back at the final resting place where everyone from Cephas's funeral was still sitting under the barrel awning, sipping on the beer. I was just looking at this old stone, I lied. Mamie's lips pursed suspiciously when she looked at Granny. Next thing I knew, Mamie was sitting on her stone, legs crossed, tapping the bell. Ding, ding, ding. We have a goner who needs help, Mamie continued to ding the bell. A goner who is as dead as yesterday. She twirled her cane around her finger. I did my best to ignore her. If Granny knew I was able to see the ghost of dead people, not just any dead people, murdered dead people, she'd have me committed for what Doc Clyde called the funeral trauma. A few months ago and a couple ghosts ago, I was knocked out cold from a big plastic Santa that Artie, from Artie's Meat and Deli, had stuck on the roof of his shop during the winter months. It just so happened I was walking on the sidewalk when the sun melted the snow away, sending the big fella off the roof right on top of me. I woke up in the hospital and saw that my visitor was one of my clients, one of my dead clients. I thought I was a goner, just like him, because my eternal slumber clients weren't alive. They were dead, and here was one standing next to me. When the harsh realization came to me that I wasn't dead and I was able to see dead people, I told Doc Clyde about it. He gave me some little pills and diagnosed me with the funeral trauma, aka a case of the crazies. He was nice enough to say he thought I had been around dead bodies too long since I'd grown up in the funeral home with Granny and my parents. My parents took early retirement and moved to Florida, while my granny also retired, leaving me and my sister, Charlotte Ray, in charge. Well? Granny tapped her toe and crossed her arms. Are you coming back to finish this funeral or not? She gave me the stink eye, along with a once-over, before she slung back the can and finished off the beer. Are you feeling all right? I'm feeling great, Zulafay Rain's pain. Mamie Sue leaned her cane up against her stone. She jumped down and clasped her hands in front of her. She stretched them over her head. She jostled her head side to side. Much better now that I can move about, thanks to Emily. Ahem. I cleared my throat. Yes, I smiled and passed Granny on the way back over to Cephas Hardy's funeral. I'm on my way back. Wait, Mamie called out. I was murdered. Aren't you going to help me? Everyone said that you were the one to help me. Everyone? I groaned and glanced back. Mamie Sue Preston planted her hands on her small hips. Her eyes narrowed. Her bubbly personality had dimmed. She'd been dead a long time. She wasn't going anywhere anytime soon, and neither was I. Chapter 2. What was going on with you at the cemetery this morning? Charlotte Ray asked once she pushed open my office door. She leaned on the door frame and tapped the toe of her fancy black high-heeled shoe. Her long red hair cascaded down the front of her shoulders. Her green eyes bored into me. She drummed her fingers together, tapping her perfectly manicured pink fingernails together. She wore a pair of black slacks, a white blouse, and hot pink jewelry to finish off the look. Nothing was going on with me, I responded and took my hands out of the filing cabinet. I pushed the drawer back. There was only one person who knew about my gift as a betweener, Sheriff Jack Henry Ross, my boyfriend, and Sleepy Hollow's head law enforcer. I closed the filing cabinet where we kept the files of our clients who were already 6 feet under. There wasn't a file anywhere on Mamie Sue Preston. When I'd gotten home from sticking Cephas in the ground, I had scoured the funeral home files in the attic, in the basement, and in my office. There hadn't been any sign of her on paper or in ghost form. She hadn't shown up since I'd seen her near her grave. Why are you in the past client files? Charlotte Ray asked. She walked into my office. Her eyes slid over to the old filing cabinet. And it's your business? I asked. We are partners, She reminded me how convenient that word was when she needed it to be. You stick with selling the packages and creating new business while I stick with the dead. I grabbed my phone off the desk. Charlotte Ray and I had one thing in common, our last name. In fact, Charlotte was reluctant to go to mortuary school while I had been chomping at the bit to get there. When we took over Eternal Slumber after Granny retired, Charlotte made it clear she was in charge of the day-to-day office duties. She met with families, did the interior decorating, you know, the clean, don't get your hands dirty stuff. The rest was left up to me. I didn't mind picking up the bodies and making sure the funeral arrangements were in place. Everything went smoothly during the service. The gravesite was prepared for burial. The cemetery stone was ordered. The list went on and on. "Now where are you going?" she asked in a cross tone. "Do you need me for something?" I asked. The information I needed was not in the cabinet. It was in Granny's head. "I wanted to make sure you were ready for Junior's funeral." "Have I ever not been ready?" I asked. There was some reason she was keeping tabs on me, and I wasn't sure what it was. Charlotte Ray never came into my office, and she never asked where I was going, nor had she ever cared. "Maybe we can walk down to Higher Grounds Cafe." She faked a yawn. "I could use an afternoon cup of pick-me-up." "Nah." I shooed her off and cha-chaed past her, almost knocking into John Howard Lloyd. "Hey, John Howard."
"Afternoon, Emily.
He stalled and looked between me and Charlotte Ray.
"Can I have a word with you, ma'am?"
"Sure." I checked the time on my phone. I wanted to get over to Sleepy Hollow Inn to get some answers about Mamie Sue Preston before the inn guest got restless and wanted dinner.
"Miss Charlotte?"
John Howard nodded his unruly head of hair and walked past her before she scampered away. "Thank you," I said for making Charlotte Ray scurry away. She wasn't good with working with the Salt of the Earth employees at Eternal Slumber.
"For what, ma'am?"
John Howard tucked his dirt-stained fingers in the bib of his overalls. "Nothing." I gestured for him to sit down in one of the chairs in front of my desk. "How can I help you?" I asked.
"Well,"
he stalled.
"I hate to ask, but..."
I know, I interrupted. I ran my hands down my dull brown hair and tucked a strand behind my ear. "You do deserve a raise. I know it's hard to be the only employee who digs the graves. Plus, you do all the landscaping, which looks great." I ripped a piece of paper out of the notebook and grabbed a pen. I scribbled a number on the paper. "How about this?" I pushed the paper onto the edge of the desk. He eased up on the chair and took a look.
"That's mighty nice of you, Emily."
He folded his hands and sat back.
"But Odell and B. Allen Burns..."
"Are you telling me that Burns' funeral is already trying to steal you away from me?" I swear smoke was coming out of my ears. John Howard Lloyd had come to town years ago, needing a job. Granny had given him one with no questions asked. Luckily, he stayed on when Charlotte Ray and I took over. He was the gravedigger and groundskeeper of the funeral home. I'd had no idea that my competitor, Burns Funeral, was trying to steal him away from me. "Isn't it enough Odell just beat Granny in the mayoral election?" I spat. "Since his sister came back to town and started running the funeral home, I'll bet she's after all my employees." I made a quick mental note to check on the status of all the staff at Eternal Slumber and make sure they were happy with their jobs. B. Allen Burns hadn't lived in Sleepy Hollow for years. Now that her brother, Odell, was the newly elected mayor, she'd decided to stay and run the funeral home while he ran the city. "Those Burns are not going to take over all of Sleepy Hollow." I grabbed the paper, scribbled out the number, and wrote a larger number. "This is it. I can't offer any more money." I walked around and handed John Howard the piece of paper.
"Golly, Emily."
His eyes grew and he gulped.
"I wasn't expecting this. Thank you."
"Good. That's settled." I walked toward the door.
I have to get going. I've got to go see Granny at the inn.
But, Emily...
John Howard stopped me again.
This is a nice raise, and I appreciate it, but that's not what I came in here for.
It's not? I was a little confused.
No, ma'am.
He slipped the piece of paper in the front pocket of his overalls.
I was just wanting to know if you'd be interested in sponsoring me and a few fellows for the new men's softball league they got going over at the old softball junction field.
Sponsor? I asked.
Well, Burns' funeral is going to sponsor a team, and Artie's Meat and Deli is going to sponsor some fellas, and the raise is much appreciated.
He nodded his head.
But we need someone to sponsor us and provide us with things like shirts and stuff.
What kind of stuff? I questioned. How was I going to tell Charlotte Ray about the raise? Big money I just spent on keeping John Howard when he wasn't even planning on leaving.
Oh, goody!
Mamie Sue appeared. She twirled around with her hands clasped in front of her and smiled. Having no teeth didn't seem to bother her at all.
I loved going to those games. Did you say Softball Junction?
I had to ignore her so John Howard wouldn't think I was crazy.
Like gloves, shoes, shirts, balls and fees, he shrugged. That sort of stuff.
And Burns is going to have a team? I asked.
Take me out to the ball game. Take me out with the crowd.
Mamie Sue sang off key as loud as she could. She swayed her cane in the air.
Mmm. She licked her lips. I love peanuts and cracker jacks, especially those little toys that come in the box. Take me out to the ball game.
She sang as loud as she could, placing her hand over her heart. Her pillbox hat shifted slightly to the side. She quickly pushed it back in place.
Yes, ma'am, he confirmed.
Okay, I screamed over Mamie Sue. Eternal Slumber will sponsor the team, and I'm going to see if Jack Henry wants to play. John Howard's eyes squinted. He put his finger in his ear and wiggled it. I had a plan. If Burns thinks they are going to beat us on the softball field, they have another thing coming to them. Jack Henry had played high school baseball and was pretty good at it. He would be Eternal Slumber's secret weapon against Burns' funeral. What is all this screaming about? Charlotte stormed down the hall and looked into my office.
Play ball!
Mamie yelled. She swung her cane and pretended to hit an imaginary ball.
Home run!
I busted in a hysterical fit of laughter. Both Charlotte Ray and John Howard were staring at me with a slight, watchful hesitation. Was I yelling? I asked in a hushed voice. I got myself together and walked over to the door. I was checking out the acoustics in here. It's for Junior's funeral tonight. Sometimes it can get loud in here with so many people, and I think we are going to have a big crowd tonight. Junior Mullins had been the oldest citizen of Sleepy Hollow. He had spent the last part of his life in the nursing home. I was positive the town was going to send him off in style. Oh. Charlotte Ray's eyes narrowed before she spun around on the balls of her feet and darted off down the hall. So, I whispered and glanced down the hall to make sure Charlotte was back in her office. Is it okay for Jack Henry to join the team?
Sure thing, Emily.
John Howard walked out of my office with me.
So I can tell the boys you agreed to sponsoring us?
Yes, you can, I smiled. There was no way I wasn't going to, even if I had to pay for it out of my own money. I walked down the hall toward the front of the funeral home and into the vestibule. Velvet curtains hung from each window. I fluffed each one when I walked by. Dust shot out in clouds. Charlotte, I hollered out, how long has it been since you cleaned the curtains? The click of her heels getting closer made my heart beat a little faster. She peeked her head out of her office door. I never agreed to clean them. she drew back, her lashes batted. It's part of your duties to keep the funeral home appealing. I smacked the curtain and more dust came out. Yuck! You can always call Dixie. Mamie appeared in the chair next to the pedestal where the memorial cards for Junior were located. I have no idea what she is doing now that I'm dead. Poor Dixie. I hated leaving her. Mind you, it was against my will. That is why I'm still here, remember? She planted her cane on the hardwood floor and danced a jig around it. Emily! Charlotte snapped her finger in my face. I swear, just when I think you are normal, you turn around and go into la-la land. Plus, you were just screaming at the top of your lungs. Are you sure you're feeling okay? I'm fine, I assured her. I'm not. Mamie Sue gummed and licked her lips. I told you to find my teeth, did you? There is no way I can go to a ball game like this. She smacked her lips together. A hollow sound came out. I giggled. I'm fine, I said again to Charlotte Ray. I'll get the cleaning taken care of before the service tonight if you are so busy. As weird as it sounded, funerals were a big deal in the South, a big send-off where everyone in town showed up. In fact, funerals around these parts were bigger than weddings. Women spent hours in the kitchen making food for the after-service. It was sort of a competition to see who made what and whose dish was best. I'd get several calls leading up to the day of a funeral from the auxiliary women telling me what they were bringing so it wasn't duplicated. I had to keep notes on who was bringing what dish. It was a big no-no to have two of the same food item. Beulah Page Belfry had already called to let me know she had made a new recipe that everyone was going to die for. I was excited to see what it was and how everyone was going to react to it, especially the auxiliary women. The auxiliary women were a bunch of local women with nothing to do but sit around in their fancy clothes and gossip. Beulah Page was in charge of them and whom they invited to become a member. One time, they extended me an invitation, but it was quickly recanted after I was diagnosed with a funeral trauma. Everything is great. I opened the front door of the funeral home and didn't bother saying goodbye to Charlotte Ray before I slammed the door behind me. Chapter 3 I'm assuming you can still hear me and see me, Mamie yammered. She continued to keep up with me as I crossed the street. The fastest way to get to the Sleepy Hollow Inn was to cross through the town square, the patch of property in the middle of town that was surrounded by its four major streets. Yes, I ducked behind one of the trees and looked around to make sure no one was looking at me. The last headache I needed was someone seeing me talk to myself. Then they'd tell Granny, who would call Doc Clyde, who would then ask me to come in for a crazy check. I muttered, this has to be on the down low. I can't let people see me talking to the air. They all think I'm crazy as it is. You aren't, she protested and stuck her cane in the grass. You are an angel helping all of us. I have a lot of questions to ask you, but first I need to find your file, and Granny will know where that is. I pointed to the inn. Zulafay? Mamie Sue asked. She fiddled with the big diamond ring on her finger. Are you saying that Zulafay is at the inn with Ruthie Sue? Granny owns the inn. I had forgotten that Mamie had been dead before Earl Way had died. I looked around the square to make sure we were still alone. People were beginning to walk around the square and the streets. Most everything you needed could be found in any one of the shops on one of the four streets that bordered the square. I couldn't let anyone see me, and being sneaky was very important to my betweener job. The square was where all the local festivities took place. The park-like setting had a gazebo in the middle, along with benches. Many people spent their lunch hours there, and even the tourists loved to picnic there. Sleepy Hollow was a number one destination for cave exploration and hiking the gorges. The mountainous backdrop of our small town was home to many beautiful caves and cave tours. It was our bread and butter for a good economy. The Sleepy Hollow Inn was on the opposite side of the square. It was as pretty as a postcard nestled at the foothills of the mountain. Granny owned and operated the inn after her second husband, Earl Way Payne, died. That was when she retired from the funeral home business. I wish I could say she left for good, but Granny had her nose in everyone's business, including mine. Earl Way left the inn to Zula and not Ruthie? There was an element of surprise on Mamie Sue's face. Long story short, I took a deep breath. Earl Way divorced Ruthie Sue and married Granny. When he died, he left his half of the inn to Granny. Then Ruthie died. I left out the part that Ruthie Sue had been murdered and was my first betweener client. And Granny got the inn by default. Interesting. Mamie Sue took my explanation without more questions. I'm sure you don't remember me. I remember you when you were a little squirt running around the funeral home during services. Your mama and daddy used to get on you. But Zula, Mamie Sue shook her head. She always told them to leave you alone. I smiled. The good old days. The memories were burned in my mind. Then I think you went off to school. I did. I peeked around the tree. No one was around. I knew I wanted to follow in my family's business, so I went to mortuary school. What did you do? I didn't know a thing about Mamie Sue. Maybe a few questions could lead to answers of people in her past, along with motives for her murder. I did a little of this and that, she shrugged. The sounds of children caught my attention. They were running and kicking balls with their parents close behind them. I slipped out from behind the tree and set my sights on the inn. The inn never had vacancies. It was the only place to stay in town, and reservations were made at least a year in advance. Plus, Granny's home-cooked meals were to die for. I had tried to talk her into hiring a catering service, but she said there was nothing doing. They are guests in my home, and I will cook for them. Good Southern hospitality, Emily. She would shake her fist at me. That's why Eternal Slumber is so successful. They knew I would take care of their loved ones just like family. She was right. Charlotte Ray and I did keep things running as smoothly as Granny had, at least most of the time, and to the public eye. The long front porch of the inn was lined with rocking chairs. They were currently occupied by inn guests, each with a glass of Granny's sweet tea in hand. The screen door screeched when I opened it to let myself in. The open foyer was filled with more guests waiting for the dining room to open. They filtered into the room on the right, which Granny made sure to keep stocked with snacks throughout the day. Running the inn was right up her alley. She loved to entertain and cook, not to mention how she loved the attention. The snack room was always filled with good cookies, hors d'oeuvres, and tea. Sweet tea. Good evening, I greeted Granny with a kiss when I walked into the kitchen. She smelled of cinnamon and sugar. Something smells good. I stuck my nose in the air and took a deep breath. I opened one of her many stove doors and looked in. I guess Zula Faye looks good. Mamie Sue was almost nose to nose with Granny, taking a good look at her. Ahem, I cleared my throat. Don't you open that door. Granny grabbed the towel off her shoulder and smacked me with it. You are going to ruin my apple pies for Junior Mullins in service tonight. Granny was such a pretty woman, with her short, flaming red hair and beautiful emerald eyes. She was a feisty one. I have you down for peach pie, not apple pie. My eyes narrowed. I knew I wasn't mistaken. I got excited when she told me she was making my favorite pie. I think B. Allen Byrne said she was bringing... Realization had set in. Granny was going to sabotage B. Allen. Granny! What? Granny asked, all innocent. Somehow, Granny had known B. Allen was making apple pie and had changed her dessert. B. Allen hadn't lived in Sleepy Hollow for years. Odell, her brother, and owner of Byrne's funeral, Eternal Slumber's direct competitor, ran against Granny for mayor of Sleepy Hollow. B. Allen already signed up to bring apple pie. Odell Burns beat you fair and square, I said. Granny didn't like losing, especially to a Burns, our only competition in Sleepy Hollow. I didn't know B. Allen was already in the loop. She did just move back from God knows wherever she has been living. Besides, Granny smoothed her hands down her apron. She's been gone so long, she's green as a gourd. She doesn't know how to make a good homemade pie. Granny warned, half serious. Her idea of homemade is grabbing a pie from Artie's. She picked up the salt shaker and took the lid off the simmering pot of green beans. She shook the hell out of the shaker. Salt poured out. I don't know why she felt like she needed to move back and run the funeral home for Odell. It's not like being mayor of Sleepy Hollow is a full-time job. Granny ran through the list of mayoral duties. Most of them were just a few minutes here and there, while others were duties requiring a couple hours a week. Still, Granny was right. There was really no reason for Odell to lessen his duties as the director of Burns' funeral and let B. Allen take over. And homemade crust? My eyes widened and my mouth watered. She's been working on it all day. Hetty Bell pushed her way through the swinging kitchen doors, shook her head, and put some empty glasses on a round serving tray before filling them with champagne and a chaser of orange juice. Hetty Bell owned Pose and Relax. It was the yoga studio next to Eternal Slumber. She also worked for Granny when Granny needed her around the inn. Hetty was good at everything. She cleaned, did laundry, made the guest rooms look nice, cooked, and even helped Granny serve the meals. Of course, I chipped in when there weren't any funerals to attend to. We all chipped in. Hetty glanced my way with a little smirk on her face. She blew her bangs out of her eyes. Her face danced along with her smile. She knew Granny was up to something. Granny always was. Who told you B. Allen was making the apple pie? I asked. Mind your own business. Granny shrugged and stirred the green beans before she put the lid back on. It is my business. The funeral is my business, I reminded her. I keep a list of foods and who is bringing what, and you are bringing peach pie. My mouth watered. Did you come here to scold me, or did you want something? Because I am busy. She pointed to the door. I have a line of people I need to feed. There was no sense in arguing with her. Zula Faye Rain's pain was used to getting her way. Though she lost the mayoral election by 2 votes, she was bound and determined to come out on top somehow. If B. Allen would be mad about Granny's delicious pie, then she was going to have to get mad. It was out of my hands, so I dropped it. I'm going to start seating people, Hetty said before she disappeared through the door with a tray of cocktails in her hands. Granny, I was wondering about that gravestone with that bell on top of it. I wasn't sure how to bring up questions about Mamie Sue and figure out exactly who she was. Neither Granny nor Mamie Sue seemed fond of the other, but the fact still remained, I needed to get Mamie to the other side. And the only way to do that was to bring her killer to justice. I even went to the funeral home and checked the old client files, but there wasn't a file with Mamie Sue's name on it. You won't find one. She's a Burns lover. Granny's eyes hooded. Why do you want to know about old Mamie Sue Preston? She waved the green bean ladle in the air. Juice went flying everywhere. I have never seen a bell on a tombstone like that before. I tried to play it off the best I could. It's interesting. Granny took the towel off her shoulder and poured 2 tall glasses of iced tea. She carried them over to the table and patted the seat. Come on over. She took a long drink from one of the glasses. I need a break. All this talk about B. Allen and apple pie has got me all worked up. I sat down next to Granny, but my mind wasn't on drinking tea. I was trying to formulate a way to get into Burns and check out their files, specifically Mamie Sue's. She'd jumped ship. Granny's eyes peered over the rim of the glass. She took another drink, as if to wash down the nasty taste or thought of Mamie Sue switching funeral home sides. According to Granny, you were either on Burns's team or Eternal Slumber's team. If your ancestors were buried at Eternal Slumber, it was the same down the generation. Evidently, Mamie Sue didn't follow in her family footsteps. When the old bat died, I went to the family estate to collect the clothes she had picked out to be buried in and found out she had changed her pre-need arrangements a few months before. Granny's eyes flew open with amusement. I'm glad she switched to Burns. She had the ugliest green suit picked out. I mean ugly. I'd rather be buried in a crocus sack than the get-up she had picked out. Granny pushed her fingers in her short red hair, giving it a little lift. Mamie's face drew, her eyes narrowed. She straightened her shoulders and her face softened. I want her to know this outfit is made from the finest fabrics, something you can't get around this town. Me? Granny laid her hand on her chest. I have a gorgeous outfit, so when I see all my men on the other side, they are going to fight over me. Granny winked, stood up, and did a little butt shake on her way back over to the counter. Good golly, Granny, I laughed. What am I going to do with you? Love me? Stop asking questions about the dead? Let the dead stay that way.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.